leading in turbulent times. I'm so sorry for the delay. We've had a little bit of technical difficulties, but we're so thrilled that you're here to join us. Today's webinar is sponsored by Georgetown University's Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you again for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I am the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Gary Hayes. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar about 1 week after today on our website. There are two audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial into the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you are welcome to use one. It is important to note if you do experience audio difficulties while listening via your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open, so we suggest that you close out some of those and join us at the conference bridge number. Questions are welcome. Gary's going to set aside some time today to answer any questions you may have. So during the presentation, if any of those come to mind, please type your questions into the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel, and I'll receive those and then read those aloud to Gary during the Q&A portion. The PowerPoint slides of this presentation will be emailed out to the group afterwards. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area option if possible. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our presenter, Gary. For the past 15 years, Gary Hayes has been providing senior-level coaching and consultation to organizations ranging from startups to large multinational corporations. His work combines results-oriented leadership and organizational development with the design and implementation of international human resources strategies and planning programs. Gary approaches management and organizational development from an integrated systems perspective, and he has extensive experience in the areas of assessment, competency modeling, succession planning, and coaching leaders and executive teams. His clients have included retail and consumer groups, companies, financial service corporations, and legal, accounting, educational, and healthcare firms. Gary also has in-depth experience providing coaching and professional development consultation to international assignees, as well as implementing and designing cross-cultural programs at global Fortune 100 corporations. A licensed practicing psychologist and psychoanalyst, Gary received his PhD in counseling psychology from Columbia, as well as a master's degree in international affairs, psychological counseling, and counseling psychology from Columbia, and has a BS in foreign service from Georgetown University. Without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Gary and thank him in advance for his time today.
Thanks very much, Emily. And of course, the most important credential today is my Georgetown alum status. And I believe I'm primarily speaking to Georgetown alumni today. I'm sorry. I appreciate you taking the time in the middle of your day. I hope you'll find this presentation interesting. I certainly found my experience in both preparing to write this book as well as writing it to be a particularly interesting one. Today I'm going to hit some highlights for you, both about what went into our thinking behind this book as well as about the book itself. The core of the project was a series of interviews with 35 CEOs from around the world. And that included Russia, China, the Middle East, Europe, the US, and Latin America. I think we were particularly lucky because my co-author, Kevin Kelly, who's the CEO of the global search firm Hydrogen Struggles, spent more than a decade of his professional life working and leading organizations in Asia. And so we have, I think, an especially interesting collection of Asian CEOs in our book. Both India and East Asia are heavily represented. Since this was truly a global turbulence, having this kind of representation in the book was something we were very excited about. I can also tell you that it made the interviews we did challenging sometimes in terms of time zones, but always especially interesting. And I'll be talking to you about some of those today as well. Our project really started with a week that many of us would like to forget. Certainly storm clouds were appearing for a number of weeks, if not months, but the filing for bankruptcy of Lehman Brothers on September 15th was really the opening of the floodwaters. We had originally thought of a different title for this book. We had originally been talking about a title something like Leading Against Headwinds. After the Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy, Headwinds was no longer nearly strong enough to capture this sense of what people were struggling with to lead their companies, and we went into Turbulence. The interviews were conducted during much of 2009. So the early interviews that we did were with CEOs who were still beginning to come to terms with what the crisis was and not knowing the duration or even the intensity of where it would go. So those were particularly interesting interviews. Obviously, this was a financial crisis, really second only to the Great Depression in the 30s. But it was more than that to us. It was also a global leadership crisis. And we decided to write our book from the perspective of the leadership challenges that were involved in leading at this particular time. Just to set the mood for what we were experiencing, we asked leaders around the world, how did they galvanize their troops rather than set off a mutiny? Clearly, rapid decisions were made, whole new assessments of risk management were required, and just as we know from past literature, strong leadership can often provoke strong reactions or even mutinies if we think of that great white whale. And in trying to set a tone or find a context for the stories we heard, a very interesting story called Winter Horses was told to us by George Halvorsen, who's the CEO of Kaiser Permanente Foundation, the national healthcare organization. And the story he got to with Winter Horses, we thought, captured a lot of the challenge that many leaders were having after we went through a period of a huge expansionary bull market to not only a bear market, but an experience of a lot of anxiety and a lot of uncertainty for people involved. So let me tell you the Winter Horses story. A young manager had a highly delegating management style. Delegated as much as he could and took great pride in doing so. Then a crisis arose and he needed things done and done in a hurry. He became more authoritative. We need to do this. We need to do that. We need you to do this by Friday, he told his people. Did they rally to him? Did they appreciate that his formerly easygoing management style was a luxury the organization could ill afford at that precise moment? No, of course not. The result was a complete backlash. The staff rapidly reached the point of rebellion or mutiny. Puzzled by this, the manager went to his boss and explained that his staff were mutinous and emotionally distraught. His leadership was simply not working, he confessed. His boss was a highly experienced leader, one of those managerial sages you come across, hopefully early in your career. The problem is, you've got winter horses, he said straight away. What's a winter horse? Replied the confused manager. The boss had grown up on a farm on the Minnesota-South Dakota border. He explained that on the farm they had some riding horses, which they would ride during the summer. Then in the fall they would put them in the barn to protect them from the freezing temperatures of winter. Come spring, when they wanted to ride the horses again, they put the saddles on and the horses would buck them off. They would have to re-break the horses every spring. To solve the problem and avoid the long drawn-out process of breaking the horses in every year, they changed the process at least once a month throughout the winter. They went into each stall, put a saddle on the horse, and then rode it around the barn, or in some cases led the horse around the barn to get it used to the saddle. By spring, the horses were comfortable with saddles and being ridden. What you have here are winter horses, explained the boss. You've delegated so completely that they have no sense at all that there's a hierarchy. They have no sense that it's really a good idea, good for everyone, for them to act like a team and do things with you to get through this crisis. They're resisting you emotionally and probably don't even know why. They're just bucking you off because you haven't done that kind of thing for a while. I recommend that once you do, you meet with them once every month, but probably every week, to go through things as a group. spend some time monitoring more closely what they're doing and getting involved more directly in the management process. Don't micromanage, but just keep them in an emotional context that says there is a hierarchy and we're all in it together. I'm used to being told what to do with no memory of previous recessions. There are a lot of winter horses out there, or at least there were a year ago. Maybe today people have a little bit more understanding of the need for both structure and leadership. But as this crisis was breaking now almost a year and a half ago, there was a lot of reaction against strong leadership. So what does it mean? How do you get the best performance from them? It really is about people first. Leading in turbulent times is about getting people behind you and galvanized. Really, doesn't it all come down to people anyway? If you're dealing with any sort of change, how you manage people is critical. What is amazing that when we study business at university or business school, you spend 95% of the time learning about strategy, marketing, corporate finance, organizational structures, and the rest, and about 5% on people skills. Yet when we finish our studies and start working, we immediately find the ratio exactly the inverse. Personnel, people issues fill the days, whether you're working in an organization of 10 or 10,000. Day to day, every plan you make and every strategy you devise revolves around having the right people in place. And that's a lot of what Hayes Brunswick works on. It's helping leaders and helping managers not set a strategy, but helping them execute it with their people. We like to say that we come in when McKinsey goes out. Namely, we're there to help leaders work with their people to get the strategy or get the change executed and have the right people in place. Our research shows that there are three key factors that keep employees happy, engaged, and loyal to the company. These constitute the underlying objectives in everything that leaders do. They are showing interest in what their people do, namely in their technical and market knowledge, marketing, finance, consulting, and whatever industry they're in. They need to know that their leader is interested in them. Compensation. Not just what people are paid in their bonuses, but that they're compensated fairly and equitably. Being treated fairly is one of the three key issues that people look for. And thirdly, learning. When candidates approach a search firm, i.e. to leave their firm, it's usually because they feel they have stopped learning and developing in their current firm. Today we look for leaders who are constantly coming back to that third point. Learning. Learning is the most critical variable for their career. Generation Y, those born between 1977 and 2005, will have an average of 14 jobs by the time they are 38 years of age. It seems to us that organizations that are going to succeed in the long term are those that provide their employees with the right learning opportunities. When we're promoting people or looking for future leaders, or always look closely at how they encourage, develop, and train the talent below them. We heard that again and again, that even in the midst of the crisis, the leaders we interviewed had to be focused on developing their people, not just to get through the crisis, but to hold the organization together as the crisis subsides. Out of all of our interviews, three common themes consistently came out. Passion, people, and by that we mean really communication, and long-term vision. Here I thought we might like to do our first poll. In thinking about a crisis, and thinking about what a leader must do, I'm going to ask Emily to do the polling process that's possible to see, what do you think? Do you think what's most important for a leader in a crisis is to show passion, to show utter commitment to communication, or utter prioritization around their long-term vision? Emily, do you want to help with this this piece of the polling? Hello?
Gary?
Yes.
I'm going to go ahead and launch this poll.
Good.
Okay, here we go. And the audience members, if the poll should be up on your screen now. And if you want to go ahead and vote. Okay. Going to give people a couple more minutes to put in their vote. All right. And put it up there. So it looks like the results are in, and about 88% of folks think communication is most critical, and 13% say vision.
Great. Interesting. Well, I'm going to come back to this once again at the end of our presentation, but I would say we have a quite astute audience because I think as we go through all three critical variables, while they all have extreme importance, perhaps the one that requires the most time and attention is communication. And so we'll be saying quite a bit about that. But we'll go a little bit further with this now. Let's start with passion. Passion. How does a leader maintain their passion at a time when every aspect of their own confidence is being challenged? How do they maintain their own stamina and their own enthusiasm so that they can demonstrate that their passion has not faded? Many CEOs talked about drawing strength for their teams, but also drawing strength from other things outside. Perhaps the most common area that CEOs talked about is drawing strength from their families, being able to balance away from work time with their family members that they cared most about as a way of recharging their batteries. Sorry for that. What people went on to talk about is how do they do that as the crisis goes on? You may know the character for crisis is actually two Chinese characters written together, danger and opportunity. And the question is, how do you sustain passion so that you can move through the dangers that a crisis represents and reach the opportunity? Wang Xizhou was the CEO of China Mobile, said, the more the environment changes, the more passion a leader should possess. Jim Skinner, the head of McDonald's, came out with, you work for the company, you don't work for your boss. This is part of why the leader maintaining such strong passion about the firm is so important for maintaining the motivation of the employees in the firm. He went on, if you don't believe in your firm and its brand, you can't do your job with enthusiasm or passion. Victor Feng, who runs the global conglomerate Li & Fung out of Hong Kong, was at a CEO dinner back in Asia earlier last year. One of the CEOs at that dinner stood up, and Feng was one of the CEOs we interviewed, so he told us this story. The war for talent is over. Talent won. Everyone at the dinner laughed, but I think he's right. If you don't find a way to keep talent passionate and maintain and demonstrate your own passion, you will lose the war for talent. In fact, let me give you a snapshot of some future leaders that we've been studying and that need what they need to be developed now. What they need to maintain their passion. Since the entire destiny of a company becomes tied up with an individual's performance, their story becomes the company's story. Their success is the company's success. When things go right, everyone says it must be the leader. And when things go wrong, the leader is equally blamed. I mentioned that my co-author is the CEO of Heidrick & Struggles. Heidrick is doing an interesting project of assessing young global leaders for the World Economic Forum. here are some of the young leaders in the U.S. that were identified for this year. There are 230 in the world. You can see these American representatives. What's fascinating is that they come from all different industries. They come from education. They come from the not-for-profit world. And yet there was a consistency in the criteria of what made these individuals exceptional future global leaders. And here it is. It's not technocratic ability alone. In fact, one of the first criteria was being a Renaissance person, having a broad view of what's occurring across the world and being integrating things of all different domains of knowledge. Renaissance, the liberal arts education that we all loved at Georgetown, is not redundant or irrelevant. It's more relevant than it ever has been. A global outlook, quite obvious, I think, for a globally integrated world. The new leaders coming today must maintain a global outlook. They must be able to cope with rapid career progress because things are moving very fast. Remember the 14 jobs before they're in their late 30s. Openness to change, both around their career and around their business. High achievement or high drive. High ethical standards. Obviously, the scandals that we have experienced in the business community over the past several years make it clear that high ethical standards are not a luxury but a necessity for successful leadership. And most of all, resilience. We were talking about how you maintain passion by maintaining your resilience. And these are really core criteria that most of the CEOs, if not all in our book, demonstrated across the board. I think it's interesting to see how much emphasis is placed on global, integrated, and flexible leadership. The old idea of a command and control leader seems quite out of date today. One point worth adding is around work-life balance. Most Generation Y businessmen and women declare that they want to be a CEO, but they only want to work 40 hours a week. It's a challenge. Most of the CEOs we interviewed work 60 to 80 hours a week. Being global means some part of your business is running every hour of the day. So we might want to think about later any questions you have about how this global all-on leader maintains some balance in their life. It's a very interesting issue to me. And then back to our issue of a crisis, danger and opportunity, and how one maintains passion through that. Henry Fernandez, who's the CEO of MSCI Barra, when you look through your newspapers and you see the stock indices from around the world, you'll see MSCI often being the lead stock index outside the United States. Henry is the CEO of the firm. He took it public away from Morgan Stanley 2 years ago. He's also shares the distinction of being an alum in my class of Georgetown graduates as well. But Henry has made the point repeatedly to his troops and to his clients that this crisis is too big an opportunity to waste. What he meant by that is that it is a time for innovation. It's a time to be able to change business models, to reach out to both clients and employees differently and in new ways. And that in this sense, he used the crisis as a way of re-galvanizing his company and has taken them, you may have followed, he's just done and is concluding $1 billion acquisition or merger this summer, which is now public. Very, very interesting way to use a crisis. Before we move into part two of the presentation, let me ask if there are any questions. Emily, is there a way you can facilitate questions at this time, if there are any?
Yeah, sure. I've gotten one. Let me pull it up here. Let's see. One question I have. Which leader or leaders seems to use and exude passion most effectively among those that you've interviewed with?
Well, it's an interesting question, and Actually, it's an easy answer given that I had just been talking about Henry. And I'm not only using him as the example because he's a Georgetown alum, but I'm happy to do that. Henry is a very interesting individual. He is Nicaraguan by birth. His father was the last head of the military before the Sandinistas took over the country. And he is a very passionate and fiery individual. Henry is quoted perhaps more than any other CEO in our book, even though MSCI Barra is not one of the largest of the companies in the book, because his quotes were so passionate and so gripping that he kept coming up in the many different issues that we expressed. But there's a many different kinds of passion. His is a very expressive passion, a very South American passion. But there have been Asian leaders who, in their visionary view, and we'll move to that third criteria quickly, had such an extraordinary passion for the vision and the long-term perspective they take with their companies. One of the Mahindra brothers from Mahindra and Mahindra in India is a good example, and I'll talk about him later and what he was able to do because of his passion for his long-term vision. So I think in the global context, there are many different styles of passion. Some are very expressive and some are much more reserved. But all of our leaders found a way to express their passion. Thanks.
If you don't mind, I have one other question I'd like to feed to you.
Sure.
From one of our audience members who's asked, which experiences are best to develop leadership skills?
Well, the research on that is pretty clear at this point. The Center for Creative Leadership has been doing research on Fortune 500 executives for more than two decades now. And they run not just a research program, but a major training facilities in both North Carolina and Denver. They're a not-for-profit supported by most of the Fortune 500 in the United States. And interestingly, the number one issue that they continue to find as most developmental is on-the-job experience. That consistently having stretch assignments, having new assignments, moving from staff jobs to line jobs, moving from line jobs to staff jobs, gaining international experience, all of these different on-the-job experiences end up becoming the most important single developmental experience and opportunity for people. Those can be greatly enhanced through actual training programs, or through executive coaching, where you have a coach that helps you think through how best to handle the new assignment, how most to learn. One whole practice area for Hayes Brunswick, not to make it a commercial, but it is executive coaching, where developing leaders have a coach to talk through the challenges and the learning opportunities on their jobs. But it all comes back to getting the key diversified work experiences and getting them as early and frequently in one's career as possible.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, we can have questions again at the end, but let's move on sort of to our part two. I'm sorry, that was our question slide. People in communication. There really are two important sides to communication, our effective communication. One is keeping people informed, and the other is the X factor. Obviously, in a crisis, people crave information. They crave currency of what's happening and what it means to them. So an all-out campaign to keep people informed is critical. All of the leaders we spoke about both through electronic, written, and travel, keeping people as informed as possible. The CEO of PricewaterhouseCoopers spent weeks and weeks on the road trying to talk with every partner around the world at PwC about what was happening to the firm and what the firm's plans for managing it were. Certainly, IQ of a leader is very important in being able to shape and communicate effectively the information that's needed. Here's training, education can also help someone become a better communicator, a better informer, a clearer informer. But in fact, it's the X factor here that we think makes real communication at the time of a crisis even more important. And that's this other side of informing, which is listening. Getting out and listening to one's people, making sure people feel listened to, taking the time to listen when you're in a crisis is very, very difficult to do. But it became one of the single most important issues the leaders talked to us about, both by making people feel valued and also hearing what they might have to say that could be helpful. Listening became a critical side of communication, effective communication. Taking the time to listen is where it begins. And then showing empathy. Empathy is not sympathy, but it's really showing an appreciation for the emotions of the other person. You may have heard about the whole notion of EQ, or emotional quotient of intelligence. How able a leader is to express genuine concern and genuine understanding of the emotions of the people following them is really a critical piece. It becomes an essential piece during the crisis when people's worries and fears are at their highest. So we begin with taking the time to listen, and then there's a huge leadership challenge around emotional intelligence to help you be able to appreciate and make your followers appreciate their emotions and concerns. One more aspect of being able to listen is what we call the cultural quotient of intelligence. How do you set the table in different situations? Here you see how we would typically set the table, but we can see situations where one might set it a very different way. And with all of our focus on global leadership, having a true cultural openness, a true attempt to understand different cultural reactions, and to remember that even how you inform people at times needs to be done differently depending on the cultural audience you're speaking to, is another third critical factor. So on communication, we begin with IQ, we rely heavily on EQ, and we believe in the global context, CQ is an increasingly important, even essential variable for effective communication. Before we go to vision, let me quote what one CEO said to us about this kind of emotional understanding and people intelligence. It's what you learn after you know everything that counts. Leaders consistently transmit a lack of appreciation if they don't deal with the emotional issues of their workforce. It's very interesting. I admit to being trained as a psychologist. I admit to believing emotions are an important part of leadership and motivation. But here are CEOs around the world telling us that employees will only remain galvanized if you listen to them and you need them. You indicate their value. The third issue that our CEOs talk to us about are vision and how you separate the urgent from the most significant. One of the most obvious things that had to happen during this crisis is that risk management had to be strengthened, and many things needed to be done very quickly to stem the financial losses that were appearing. How do you take the tactical steps in the present that were needed, essential to keep your company afloat, and not compromise your long-term vision? Always try to keep the big picture in mind, Talal Al Zain, the CEO of Bahrain Holding Company, told us. If you don't, you might hold the present, but you will lose the future. One of the most interesting stories, and I alluded to Mr. Mahindra in India from Mahindra and Mahindra, told about how maintaining a long-term vision and strategy allowed them to make one of the most important tactical decisions they've made in the history of the company. You may have heard, you may recall in the press, again going back over a year now, the scandal that broke in corporate India, probably the highest level corporate scandal that had occurred, was in the technology company Satyam, where there was just gross financial fraud being practiced by the leadership of the company. The company moved into a bankruptcy position and was being broken up. In the height of the financial crisis, Mahindra was able to move in and acquire the key pieces of Satyam that they believed were important for their fulfilling their vision. That's a fascinating point to me, that a company could stay so vision-focused that in the height of this biggest financial crisis in 30 or 40 years, they were still able to take action to do something very dramatic. And Mahindra told us that he really believed it was sticking to their vision that allowed them to quickly identify why this was a key opportunity that they had to take advantage of and why they were ready to take advantage of it. Fascinating importance, I think, on vision and how it influenced people during the crisis. Keeping that long-term view, keeping that global view, really is quite critical. In medieval times, the borders of the known world stretched only as far as you could walk or ride, to the next village, the next mountain, perhaps the next seashore. A few sailors stretched the borders over and beyond the horizon, but there were still massive swaths of the globe that were terra incognita, unknown and uncharted, where danger and uncertainty lurked. The danger was so awful, it lay beyond imagination. Some mapmakers used mystical beasts and serpents to represent it. On the Lennox globe, which is now on display at the New York Public Library, the craftsman wrote Hic sunt dragones along the east coast of Asia. The translation, here be dragons, is a warning with a clear message. Ignorance is bliss. The known world is safe. Out there is dangerous. Stay where you are. Keep doing what you've always done. Yet to a few brave explorers, those words issued a silent challenge. They were the ones who realized that you will never make true progress without first taking risks. They are the ones who began a global endeavor to explore the world and push past the dragons that our global leaders have continued to do to this day. Leadership begins with people and continues with using and motivating those people to execute global franchises and global challenges each and every day. Having taken you through some of the key findings of the book, let me ask two things. Emily, maybe we should do a second poll and see if people still believe communication is key, or when we think of the passion that leaders have had to maintain to be successful, and when we think about what's happened when the long-term vision was held in place despite the crisis, we see how people vote again. Why don't we do one more poll now at the end and see what people are thinking, and then we'll open it up to any final questions.
Sure. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and launch that. So you want to ask, the most important attribute, is that different during non-crisis times or overall?
Well, let's can we do it twice? Can we ask them twice?
Sure.
Can we say, having heard the presentation, which attribute do you think is most critical, passion, communication, or vision, during the crisis? And then we're going to ask you that question again, but under less crisis-oriented times.
Okay, first, let's first ask, is passion, are the most important attributes different during non-crisis time? Folks can go ahead and vote. People a couple more minutes to put their votes in. right. Let's close it and share. So it looks like the results are in, and about 60 people said yes, it is different, and 40 said no.
Very interesting. Very interesting. So I think I would agree that while the intensity is different during a crisis, the reality is that many of these three attributes are very much the key attributes for leaders at all times. And part of the reason for that, I think, is also, while we may not always be in crisis, we are in such a time of constant change that these challenges are with leaders, whether there's a crisis or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to go ahead and launch the same question that we answered earlier today to see if folks' opinions have changed. Give people a couple minutes to vote. And the question is, having heard the presentation today, which attribute do you feel like is most important? Passion, communication, or vision? All right, I'm going to go ahead and close and share the results. About 70% of folks said communication, 20 said passion, and 10% said vision. All right.
What do we have?
All right, it looks like it was 70% communication, 20% passion, and 10% vision.
Mm. So we had a bit of an uptick in the need for passion after hearing the presentation. And I may have been guiding the witness, as lawyers say, because while I think communication is absolutely critical, I got very, very interested in this notion of passion and how a leader maintains their passion and conveys their passion. So if there's a follow-up, that may be a key focus of follow-up research that I'd like to do. So those who voted for passion, hopefully there'll be more material on the way. Emma, should we ask if there are any other questions before I lead us into our conclusion?
Sure. So I have a couple questions from the audience members, but again, I want to remind everyone that you can submit your questions in the question area of your GoToWebinar control panel, and I will receive those and then read them off to Gary. Gary, one question I received from an audience member is, do you think people can be reminded about hierarchy and fall back into the line like winter horses?
I think it's how you do it. I don't think people can be broken the way a horse is broken. Strict discipline may have been very necessary on a factory floor when if people were out of line, either the factory stopped or people could be very quickly physically hurt or injured. But today, most people are working in an information age environment, so they need to be maintained motivation from within. So I think the challenge is not simply falling back on reminding people about a hierarchy, but instead helping them understand why their role is critical for the overall organization. If people understand why they're being asked to do things a certain way, and it makes sense to them, they will be far more likely to follow and to maintain their motivation than if they're confused or alienated from either what's being asked of them or why it's being asked. So I think it's really explanation and understanding that is the critical piece for helping people ride as a team and not be bucking winter horses.
Great. Well, I have one other question I've received, and someone from the audience member wants to know how your background in psychology and being a receiving your master's in counseling has affected your research and work?
Well, first of all, it's really deepened my interest in, I think, the deeper motivations in leadership, both the issues that most engage a leader, as well as things that can block them. I went on and did my PhD in psychology and got clinically licensed as well. And then I went on and did a postdoc training in psychoanalysis. And I really do believe that while there are many things that operate on a cognitive level and on a fairly mundane level, when you're dealing with groups of people under very emotionally difficult and challenging things, deeper emotional patterns really do influence leaders a lot. Primarily now I'm working with CEOs and other C-suite leaders. When you're at that senior level of a position, all the technical knowledge is assumed, all of the financial acumen is there. It really is so much about them being able to manage their own emotional balance and respond empathically and realistically to the different emotional patterns of the senior people around them. So I think it really has colored both what I think about, but also has really helped me working with more senior leaders where these issues are quite critical.
Great, thank you. Well, I think we can go over to your conclusion section and then leave room maybe for a couple more questions.
Okay, great. So how does a leader lead? Well, it's hard to lead a cavalry if you think you look funny on a horse. Adlai Stevenson, who was both a successful leader and failed in some of his leadership objectives, I thought said that very well. Another way of saying it is you have to believe in yourself and you have to believe in the leadership you're providing. Sometimes leaders, and people talked about it in the book, can feel like an imposter, especially during a crisis when they don't have all the answers. Sometimes they don't have many of the answers. But being transparent about what you do know, again, demonstrating your passion, coming back to the vision and strategy that you formulated again and again, will keep a person credible, which is where leadership begins. And so we can end with this final quote by one of my favorite leaders. If it sounds familiar to you at all, it's not the critic who counts, but the man who is actually in the arena. At best, he knows the triumph of how achievement. Some of this, if I remember correctly, was quoted in Night in the Museum. And Theodore Roosevelt plays a very interesting role as a leader in that movie. He also, through much of the movie, is quite a mentor to our protagonist, to the night guard. But it really does talk about a leader who tries and gets into the arena is the one who inspires his troops, not one who holds back or hides, the one who knows neither victory nor defeat. So I hope this has been both interesting as well as informative for you. If you are interested in the book, the easiest way to obtain it is through Amazon.com. You can obtain either the British copy. The book was published in London at the end of last year, but it is now also available by Barrett Kohler here in the United States. If you have any other questions, you can reach me on email or through my company website. But I do appreciate you taking the time today to be with us. That's what I was looking for. I'm sorry, I wanted to put that directory information up for you. And if there are any other questions, I'll take them now. Otherwise, I thank all of you for being with us.
Thank you so much, Gary. I actually have one other question I'd like to ask you that was submitted from an audience member. Can you be more specific about what you perceive a Renaissance person is in today's climate? For example, how is Michelle Rhee a Renaissance person for you?
Well, I think a Renaissance person is one that is not siloed in their thinking. It's not a leader, and this is actually quite interesting. When we started these interviews, we assumed that the CEOs would speak almost exclusively about the financial risk and the financial difficulties they were having, either in dropping revenue or difficulties in credit markets. I spend a large part of my time in Wall Street or financial service companies. And while all of the CEOs certainly began by talking about the immediate financial challenges that the crisis thrust upon them, that is not where they stayed. They moved rapidly to a broad range of industry issues, technology issues, obviously based on the presentation today, people and leadership issues, and they wove all those concerns together. And to me, that is a real renaissance leader. Today, it's not enough to be just a technical expert. You need to be able to integrate the expertise of many technical experts to weave a tapestry to lead. And I think that was really demonstrated. If you read some of the interviews in the book, you'll see that almost all of the CEOs ranged very widely across parts of their business and even across industries to talk about what they thought the leadership challenges were.
Thank you so much, Gary. It looks like we don't have any other questions. I just want to thank you for your time. It's been a fantastic webinar and a great learning experience. And I just want to also remind all those on the line that I will be sending out a follow-up email shortly with the slides for Gary's presentation. And we will be posting a recording archive of this webinar on our website in about 1 week. So thank you to everyone, and we hope you will join us for an upcoming webinar later this summer. Have a great rest of your day.
Thanks for having me. Bye now.